Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Big Data in Practice, How 45 Successful Companies Used Big Data Analytics to Deliver Extraordinary Results, by Bernard Marr, narrated by Lyle Blaker. Limit of Liability, Disclaimer of Warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. It is sold on the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering professional services, and neither the publisher nor the author shall be liable for damages arising herefrom. If professional advice or other expert assistance is required, the services of a competent professional should be sought. Introduction. We are witnessing a movement that will completely transform any part of business and society. The word we have given to this movement is big data, and it will change everything from the way banks and shops operate to the way we treat cancer and protect our world from terrorism. No matter what job you are in, and no matter what industry you work in, big data will transform it. Some people believe that big data is just a big fad that will go away if they ignore it for long enough. It won't. The hype around big data and the name may disappear, which wouldn't be a great loss, but the phenomenon will stay and only gather momentum. What we call big data today will simply become the new normal in a few years' time, when all businesses and government organizations use large volumes of data to improve what they do and how they do it. I work every day with companies and government organizations on big data projects, and thought it would be a good idea to share how big data is used today across lots of different industries among big and small companies to deliver real value. But first things first, let's just consider what big data actually means. What is big data? Big data basically refers to the fact that we can now collect and analyze data in ways that was simply impossible even a few years ago. There are two things that are fueling this big data movement: the fact that we have more data on anything, and our improved ability to store and analyze any data. More data on everything. Everything we do in our increasingly digitized world leaves a data trail. This means the amount of data available is literally exploding. We have created more data in the past 2 years than in the entire previous history of mankind. By 2020, it is predicted that about 1.7 megabytes of new data will be created every second for every human being on the planet. This data is coming not just from the tens of millions of messages and emails we send each other every second via email, WhatsApp, Facebook, Twitter, etc., but also from the 1 trillion digital photos we take each year and the increasing amounts of video data we generate. Every single minute, we currently upload about 300 hours of new video to YouTube, and we share almost 3 million videos on Facebook. On top of that, we have data from all the sensors we are now surrounded by. The latest smartphones have sensors to tell where we are, GPS, how fast we are moving, accelerometer, what the weather is like around us, barometer, what force we are using to press the touchscreen, touch sensor, and much more. By 2020, we will have over 6 billion smartphones in the world, all full of sensors that collect data. But not only our phones are getting smart, we now have smart TVs, smart watches, smart meters, smart kettles, fridges, tennis rackets, and even smart light bulbs. In fact, by 2020, we will have over 50 billion devices that are connected to the internet. All this means that the amount of data and the variety of data, from sensor data to text and video in the world, will grow to unimaginable levels. Ability to analyze everything. All this big data is worth very little unless we are able to turn it into insights. In order to do that, we need to capture and analyze the data. In the past, there were limitations to the amount of data that could be stored in databases. The more data there was, the slower the system became. This can now be overcome with new techniques that allow us to store and analyze data across different databases in distributed locations connected via networks. So-called distributed computing means huge amounts of data can be stored in little bits across lots of databases and analyzed by sharing the analysis between different servers, each performing a small part of the analysis. Google were instrumental in developing distributed computing technology, enabling them to search the internet. Today, about 1,000 computers are involved in answering a single search query, which takes no more than 0.2 seconds to complete. We currently search 3.5 billion times a day on Google alone. Distributed computing tools such as Hadoop manage the storage and analysis of big data across connected databases and servers. What's more, big data storage and analysis technology is now available to rent in a software-as-a-service or SaaS model, which makes big data analytics accessible to anyone, even those with low budgets and limited IT support. Finally, we are seeing amazing advancements in the way we can analyze data. Algorithms can now look at photos, identify who is on them, and then search the internet for other pictures of that person. Algorithms can now understand spoken words, translate them into written text, and analyze this text for content, meaning, and sentiment. For example, are you saying nice things or not so nice things? More and more advanced algorithms emerge every day to help us understand our world and predict the future. Couple all this with machine learning and artificial intelligence, the ability of algorithms to learn and make decisions independently, and you can hopefully tell that the developments and opportunities here are very exciting and evolving very quickly. Big data opportunities. With this book, I wanted to showcase the current state of the art in big data and provide an overview of how companies and organizations across all different industries are using big data to deliver value in diverse areas. You will discover that I have covered areas including how retailers, both traditional bricks and mortar companies as well as online ones, use big data to predict trends and consumer behaviors, how governments are using big data to foil terrorist plots, even how a tiny family butcher or a zoo use big data to improve performance, as well as the use of big data in cities, telecoms, sports, gambling, fashion, manufacturing, research, motor racing, video gaming, and everything in between. Instead of putting their heads in the sand or getting lost in this startling new world of big data, the companies I have featured here have figured out smart ways to use data in order to deliver strategic value. In my previous book, Big Data, Using Smart Big Data, Analytics, and Metrics to Make Better Decisions and Improve Performance, also published by Wiley, I go into more detail on how any company can figure out how to use big data to deliver value. I am convinced that big data, unlike any other trend at the moment, will affect everyone and everything we do. You can listen to this book from beginning to end for a complete overview of current big data use cases, or you can use it as a reference book and dive in and out of the areas you find most interesting or are relevant to you or your clients. I hope you enjoy it. 1. Walmart. How big data is used to drive supermarket performance. Background. Walmart are the largest retailer in the world and the world's largest company by revenue, with over 2 million employees and 20,000 stores in 28 countries. With operations on this scale, it's no surprise that they have long seen the value in data analytics. In 2004, when Hurricane Sandy hit the U.S., they found that unexpected insights could come to light when data was studied as a whole rather than as isolated individual sets. Attempting to forecast demand for emergency supplies in the face of the approaching Hurricane Sandy, CIO Linda Dillman turned up some surprising statistics. As well as flashlights and emergency equipment, expected bad weather had led to an upsurge in sales of strawberry Pop-Tarts in several other locations. Extra supplies of these were dispatched to stores in Hurricane Francis's path in 2012 and sold extremely well. Walmart have grown their big data and analytics department considerably since then, continuously staying on the cutting edge. In 2015, the company announced they were in the process of creating the world's largest private data cloud to enable the processing of 2.5 petabytes of information every hour. What problem is big data helping to solve? Supermarkets sell millions of products to millions of people every day. It's a fiercely competitive industry, which a large proportion of people living in the developed world count on to provide them with day-to-day essentials. Supermarkets compete not just on price, but also on customer service and, vitally, convenience. Having the right products in the right place at the right time, so the right people can buy them, presents huge logistical problems. Products have to be efficiently priced to the cent to stay competitive. And if customers find they can't get everything they need under one roof, they will look elsewhere for somewhere to shop that is a better fit for their busy schedule. How is big data used in practice? In 2011, with a growing awareness of how data could be used to understand their customers' needs and provide them with the products they wanted to buy, Walmart established At Walmart Labs and their Fast Big Data team to research and deploy new data-led initiatives across the business. The culmination of this strategy was referred to as the Data Cafe, a state-of-the-art analytics hub at their Bentonville, Arkansas headquarters. At the cafe, the analytics team can monitor 200 streams of internal and external data in real time, including a 40-petabyte database of all the sales transactions in the previous weeks. Timely analysis of real-time data is seen as key to driving business performance, as Walmart senior statistical analyst Naveen Petamale tells me. If you can't get insights until you've analyzed your sales for a week or a month, then you've lost sales within that time. Our goal is always to get information to our business partners as fast as we can, so they can take action and cut down the turnaround time. It is proactive and reactive analytics. Teams from any part of the business are invited to visit the cafe with their data problems and work with the analysts to devise a solution. There is also a system which monitors performance indicators across the company and triggers automated alerts when they hit a certain level, inviting the teams responsible for them to talk to the data team about possible solutions. Petamale gives an example of a grocery team struggling to understand why sales of a particular produce were unexpectedly declining. Once their data was in the hands of the cafe analysts, it was established very quickly that the decline was directly attributable to a pricing error. The error was immediately rectified and sales recovered within days. Sales across different stores in different geographical areas can also be monitored in real time. One Halloween, Petamale recalls, sales figures of novelty cookies were being monitored when analysts saw that there were several locations where they weren't selling at all. This enabled them to trigger an alert to the merchandising teams responsible for those stores, who quickly realized that the product hadn't even been put on the shelves. Not exactly a complex algorithm, but it wouldn't have been possible without real-time analytics. Another initiative is Walmart's Social Genome Project, which monitors public social media conversations and attempts to predict what products people will buy based on their conversations. They also have the ShopeeCat service, which predicts how people's shopping habits are influenced by their friends, using social media data again, and have developed their own search engine, named Polaris, to allow them to analyze search terms entered by customers on their websites. What were the results? Walmart tell me that the Data Cafe system has led to a reduction in the time it takes from a problem being spotted in the numbers to a solution being proposed, from an average of 2 to 3 weeks down to around 20 minutes. What data was used? The Data Cafe uses a constantly refreshed database consisting of 200 billion rows of transactional data, and that only represents the most recent few weeks of business. On top of that, it pulls in data from 200 other sources, including meteorological data, economic data, telecoms data, social media data, gas prices, and a database of events taking place in the vicinity of Walmart stores. What are the technical details? Walmart's real-time transactional database consists of 40 petabytes of data. Huge though this volume of transactional data is, It only includes from the most recent week's data, as this is where the value, as far as real-time analysis goes, is to be found. Data from across the chain's stores, online divisions, and corporate units are stored centrally on Hadoop, a distributed data storage and data management system. CTO Jeremy King has described the approach as data democracy, as the aim is to make it available to anyone in the business who can make use of it. At some point after the adoption of distributed Hadoop framework in 2011, analysts became concerned that the volume was growing at a rate that could hamper their ability to analyze it. As a result, a policy of intelligently managing data collection was adopted, which involved setting up several systems designed to refine and categorize the data before it was stored. Other technologies in use include Spark and Cassandra, and languages including R and SAS are used to develop analytical applications. Any challenges that had to be overcome. With an analytics operation as ambitious as the one planned by Walmart, the rapid expansion required a large intake of new staff, and finding the right people with the right skills proved difficult. The problem is far from restricted to Walmart. A recent survey by researchers Gartner found that more than half of businesses feel their ability to carry out big data analytics is hampered by difficulty in hiring the appropriate talent. One of the approaches Walmart took to solving this was to turn to crowdsourced data science competition website Kaggle, which I profile in Chapter 44. Kaggle sent users of the website a challenge involving predicting how promotional and seasonal events, such as stock clearance sales and holidays, would influence sales of a number of different products. Those who came up with models that most closely matched the real-life data gathered by Walmart were invited to apply for positions on the data science team. In fact, one of those who found himself working for Walmart after taking part in the competition was Naveen Petamail, whose thoughts I have included in this chapter. Once a new analyst starts at Walmart, they are put through their analytics rotation program. This sees them moved through each different team with responsibility for analytical work to allow them to gain a broad overview of how analytics is used across the business. Walmart's senior recruiter for its information systems operation, Mandar Thakur, told me, "The Kaggle competition created a buzz about Walmart and our analytics organization. People always knew that Walmart generates and has a lot of data, but the best part was that this let people see how we are using it strategically." What are the key learning points and takeaways? Supermarkets are big, fast, constantly changing businesses that are complex organisms consisting of many individual subsystems. This makes them an ideal business in which to apply big data analytics. Success in business is driven by competition. Walmart have always taken a lead in data-driven initiatives, such as loyalty and reward programs, and by wholeheartedly committing themselves to the latest advances in real-time responsive analytics, they have shown they plan to remain competitive. Bricks and mortar retail may be seen as low-tech, almost Stone Age in fact, compared to their flashy online rivals, but Walmart have shown that cutting-edge big data is just as relevant to them as it is to Amazon or Alibaba. Despite the seemingly more convenient options on offer, it appears that customers, whether through habit or preference, are still willing to get in their cars and travel to shops to buy things in person. This means there is still a huge market out there for the taking, and businesses that make best use of analytics in order to drive efficiency and improve their customers' experience are set to prosper. 2. CERN: Unraveling the Secrets of the Universe with Big Data. Background: CERN are the International Scientific Research Organization that operate the Large Hadron Collider, or LHC, humanity's biggest and most advanced physics experiment. The colliders, encased in 17 miles of tunnels buried 600 feet below the surface of Switzerland and France, aim to simulate conditions in the universe milliseconds following the Big Bang. This allows physicists to search for elusive theoretical particles, such as the Higgs boson, which could give us unprecedented insight into the composition of the universe. CERN's projects, such as the LHC, would not be possible if it weren't for the internet and big data. In fact, the internet was originally created at CERN in the 1990s. Tim Berners-Lee, the man often referred to as the father of the internet, developed the hypertext protocol which holds together the World Wide Web while at CERN. Its original purpose was to facilitate communication between researchers around the globe. The LHC alone generates around 30 petabytes of information per year, 15 trillion pages of printed text, enough to fill 600 million filing cabinets, clearly big data by anyone's standards. In 2013, CERN announced that the Higgs boson had been found. Many scientists have taken this as proof that the standard model of particle physics is correct. This confirms that much of what we think we know about the workings of the universe on a subatomic level is essentially right, although there are still many mysteries remaining, particularly involving gravity and dark matter. What problem is big data helping to solve? The collisions monitored in the LHC happen very quickly, and the resulting subatomic debris containing the elusive sought-after particles exists for only a few millionths of a second before they decay. The exact conditions that cause the release of the particles which CERN are looking for only occur under very precise conditions, and as a result, many hundreds of millions of collisions have to be monitored and recorded every second in the hope that the sensors will pick them up. The LHC's sensors record hundreds of millions of collisions between particles, some of which achieve speeds of just a fraction under the speed of light as they are accelerated around the collider. This generates a massive amount of data and requires very sensitive and precise equipment to measure and record the results. How is big data used in practice? The LHC is used in four main experiments, involving around 8,000 analysts across the globe. They use the data to search for elusive theoretical particles and probe for the answers to questions involving antimatter, dark matter, and extra dimensions in time and space. Data is collected by sensors inside the collider that monitor hundreds of millions of particle collisions every second. The sensors pick up light, so they are essentially cameras with a 100 megapixel resolution capable of capturing images at incredibly high speeds. This data is then analyzed by algorithms that are tuned to pick up the telltale energy signatures left behind by the appearance and disappearance of the exotic particles CERN are searching for. The algorithms compare the resulting images with theoretical data explaining how we believe the target particles, such as the Higgs boson, will act. If the results match, it is evidence the sensors have found the target particles. What were the results? In 2013, CERN scientists announced that they believed they had observed and recorded the existence of the Higgs boson. This was a huge leap forward for science, as the existence of the particle had been theorized for decades, but could not be proven until technology was developed on this scale. The discovery has given scientists unprecedented insight into the fundamental structure of the universe and the complex relationships between the fundamental particles that everything we see, experience, and interact with is built from. Apart from the LHC, CERN has existed since the 1950s and has been responsible for a great many scientific breakthroughs with earlier experiments, and many world-leading scientists have made their name through their work with the organization. What data was used? Primarily, the LHC gathers data using light sensors to record the collision and fallout from the protons accelerated to 99.9% of the speed of light. Sensors inside the colliders pick up light energy emitted during the collisions and from the decay of the resulting particles and convert it into data which can be analyzed by computer algorithms. Much of this data, being essentially photographs, is unstructured. Algorithms transform light patterns recorded by the sensors into mathematical data. Theoretical data, ideas about how we think the particles being hunted will act, is matched against the sensor data to determine what has been captured on camera. What are the technical details? The worldwide LHC computing grid is the world's largest distributed computing network, spanning 170 computing centers in 35 different countries. To develop distributed systems capable of analyzing 30 petabytes of information per year, CERN instigated the Open Lab project in collaboration with data experts at companies including Oracle, Intel, and Siemens. The network consists of over 200,000 cores and 15 petabytes of disk space. The 300 gigabytes per second of data provided by these 7 CERN sensors is eventually whittled down to 300 megabytes per second of useful data, which constitutes the product's raw output. This data is made available as a real-time stream to academic institutions partnered with CERN. CERN have developed methods of adding extra computing power on the fly to increase the processing output of the grid without taking it offline, in times of spikes in demand for computational power. Any challenges that had to be overcome. The LHC gathers incredibly vast amounts of data very quickly. No organization on Earth has the computing power and resources necessary to analyze that data in a timely fashion. To deal with this, CERN turned to distributed computing. They had already been using distributed computing for some time. In fact, the Internet as we know it today was initially built to save scientists from having to travel to Geneva whenever they wanted to analyze results of CERN's earlier experiments. For the LHC, CERN created the LHC Distributed Computing Grid, which comprises 170 computer centers in 35 countries. Many of these are private computing centers operated by the academic and commercial organizations partnered with CERN. This parallel distributed use of computer processing power means far more calculations per second can be carried out than even the world's most powerful supercomputers could manage alone. What are the key learning points and takeaways? The groundbreaking work carried out by CERN, which has greatly improved our knowledge of how the universe works, would not be possible without big data and analytics. CERN and big data have evolved together. CERN was one of the primary catalysts in the development of the Internet, which brought about the big data age we live in today. Distributed computing makes it possible to carry out tasks that are far beyond the capabilities of any one organization to complete alone. 3. Netflix. How Netflix used big data to give us the programs we want. Background. The streaming movie and TV service Netflix are said to account for 1/3 of peak time internet traffic in the U.S., and the service now have 65 million members in over 50 countries, enjoying more than 100 million hours of TV shows and movies a day. Data from these millions of subscribers is collected and monitored in an attempt to understand our viewing habits. But Netflix's data isn't just big in the literal sense. It is the combination of this data with cutting-edge analytical techniques that makes Netflix a true big data company. What problem is big data helping to solve? Legendary Hollywood screenwriter William Goldman said, Nobody, not now, not ever, knows the least goddamn thing about what is or isn't going to work at the box office. He was speaking before the arrival of the Internet and big data, and since then, Netflix have been determined to prove him wrong by building a business around predicting exactly what we'll enjoy watching. How is big data used in practice? A quick glance at Netflix's jobs page is enough to give you an idea of how seriously data and analytics are taken. Specialists are recruited to join teams specifically skilled in applying analytical skills to particular business areas. Personalization analytics, messaging analytics, content delivery analytics, device analytics, the list goes on. However, although big data is used across every aspect of the Netflix business, their holy grail has always been to predict what customers will enjoy watching. Big data analytics is the fuel that fires the recommendation engines designed to serve this purpose. Efforts here began back in 2006. When the company were still primarily a DVD mailing business, streaming began a year later. They launched the Netflix Prize, offering $1 million to the group that could come up with the best algorithm for predicting how their customers would rate a movie based on their previous ratings. The winning entry was finally announced in 2009, and although the algorithms are constantly revised and added to, the principles are still a key element of the recommendation engine. At first, analysts were limited by the lack of information they had on their customers, only four data points: customer ID, movie ID, rating, and the date the movie was watched, were available for analysis. As soon as streaming became the primary delivery method, many new data points on their customers became accessible. This new data enabled Netflix to build models to predict the perfect storm situation of customers consistently being served with movies they would enjoy. Happy customers, after all, are far more likely to continue their subscriptions. Another central element to Netflix's attempt to give us films we will enjoy is tagging. The company pay people to watch movies and then tag them with elements the movies contain. They will then suggest you watch other productions that were tagged similarly to those you enjoyed. This is where the sometimes unusual and slightly robotic-sounding suggestions come from. In the mood for wacky teen comedy featuring a strong female lead? It's also the reason the service will sometimes, in fact in my experience, often recommend I watch films that have been rated with only one or two stars. This may seem counterintuitive to their objective of showing me films I will enjoy. But what has happened is that the weighting of these ratings has been outweighed by the prediction that the content of the movie will appeal. In fact, Netflix have effectively defined nearly 80,000 new micro-genres of movie based on our viewing habits. More recently, Netflix have moved towards positioning themselves as a content creator, not just a distribution method for movie studios and other networks. Their strategy here has also been firmly driven by their data, which showed that their subscribers had a voracious appetite for content directed by David Fincher and starring Kevin Spacey. After outbidding networks including HBO and ABC for the rights to House of Cards, they were so confident it fitted their predictive model for the perfect TV show that they bucked the convention of producing a pilot and immediately commissioned two seasons comprising 26 episodes. Every aspect of the production under the control of Netflix was informed by data. Even the range of colors used on the cover image for the series was selected to draw viewers in. The ultimate metric Netflix hoped to improve is the number of hours customers spend using their service. You don't really need statistics to tell you that viewers who don't spend much time using the service are likely to feel they aren't getting value for money from their subscriptions, and so may cancel their subscriptions. To this end, the way various factors affect the quality of experience is closely monitored, and models are built to explore how this affects user behavior. By collecting end-user data on how the physical location of the content affects the viewer's experience, calculations about the placement of data can be made to ensure there is an optimal service to as many homes as possible. What were the results? Netflix's letter to shareholders in April 2015 shows their big data strategy was paying off. They added 4.9 million new subscribers in Q1 2015, compared to 4 million in the same period in 2014. Netflix put much of this success down to their ever-improving content, including House of Cards and Orange is the New Black. This original content is driving new member acquisition and customer retention. In fact, 90% of Netflix members have engaged with this original content. Obviously, their ability to predict what viewers will enjoy is a large part of this success. And what about their ultimate metric? How many hours customers spend using the service? Well, in Q1 2015 alone, Netflix members streamed 10 billion hours of content. If Netflix's big data strategy continues to evolve, that number is set to increase. What data was used? The recommendation algorithms and content decisions are fed by data on what titles customers watch, what time of day movies are watched, time spent selecting movies, how often playback is stopped, either by the user or owing to network limitations, and ratings given. In order to analyze quality of experience, Netflix collect data on delays caused by buffering, rebuffer rate, and bit rate, which affects the picture quality, as well as customer location. What are the technical details? Although their vast catalog of movies and TV shows is hosted in the cloud on Amazon Web Services, or AWS, it is also mirrored around the world by ISPs and other hosts. As well as improving user experience by reducing lag when streaming content around the globe, this reduces costs for the ISPs, saving them from the cost of downloading the data from the Netflix server before passing it on to the viewers at home. In 2013, the size of their catalog was said to exceed 3 petabytes. This humongous amount of data is accounted for by the need to hold many of their titles in up to 120 different video formats, owing to the number of different devices offering Netflix playback. Originally, their systems used Oracle databases, but they switched to NoSQL and Cassandra to allow more complex, big data-driven analysis of unstructured data. Speaking at the Strata plus Hadoop World Conference, Kurt Brown, who leads the data platform team at Netflix, explained how Netflix's data platform is constantly evolving. The Netflix data infrastructure includes big data technologies like Hadoop, Hive, and Pig, plus traditional business intelligence tools like Teradata and MicroStrategy. It also includes Netflix's own open source applications and services, Lipstick and Genie. And, like all of Netflix's core infrastructure, it all runs in the AWS cloud. Going forward, Netflix are exploring Spark for streaming, machine learning, and analytic use cases, and they're continuing to develop new additions for their own open source suite. Any challenges that had to be overcome? Although a lot of the metadata collected by Netflix, which actors a viewer likes to watch and what time of day they watch films or TV, is simple, easily quantified structured data, Netflix realized early on that a lot of valuable data is also stored in the messy, unstructured content of video and audio. To make this data available for computer analysis and therefore unlock its value, it had to be quantified in some way. Netflix did this by paying teams of viewers, numbering in their thousands, to sit through hours of content, meticulously tagging elements they found in them. After reading a 32-page handbook, these paid viewers marked up themes, issues, and motifs that took place on screen, such as a hero experiencing a religious epiphany, or a strong female character making a tough moral choice. From this data, Netflix have identified nearly 80,000 microgenres, such as comedy films featuring talking animals, or historical dramas with gay or lesbian themes. Netflix can now identify what films you like watching far more accurately than simply seeing that you like horror films or spy films, and can use this to predict what you will want to watch. This gives the unstructured, messy data the outline of a structure that can be assessed quantitatively, one of the fundamental principles of big data. Today, Netflix are said to have begun automating this process by creating routines that can take a snapshot of the content in JPEG format and analyze what is happening on screen using sophisticated technologies such as facial recognition and color analysis. These snapshots can be taken either at scheduled intervals or when a user takes a particular action such as pausing or stopping playback. For example, if it knows a user fits the profile of tending to switch off after watching gory or sexual scenes, it can suggest more sedate alternatives next time they sit down to watch something. What are the key learning points and takeaways? Predicting what viewers will want to watch next is big business for networks, distributors, and producers, all roles that Netflix now fill in the media industry. Netflix have taken the lead, but competing services such as Hulu and Amazon Instant Box Office, and soon Apple, can also be counted on to be improving and refining their own analytics. Predictive content programming is a field in which we can expect to see continued innovation, driven by fierce competition as time goes on. Netflix have begun to build the foundations of personalized TV, where individual viewers will have their own schedule of entertainment to consume, based on analysis of their preferences. This idea has been talked about for a long time by TV networks, but now we are beginning to see it become a reality in the age of big data. 4. Rolls-Royce. How big data is used to drive success in manufacturing. Background. Rolls-Royce manufacture enormous engines that are used by 500 airlines and more than 150 armed forces. These engines generate huge amounts of power, and it's no surprise that a company used to dealing with big numbers have wholeheartedly embraced big data. What problem is big data helping to solve? This is an extremely high-tech industry where failures and mistakes can cost billions and human lives. It's therefore crucial the company are able to monitor the health of their products to spot potential problems before they occur. The data Rolls-Royce gathers helps them design more robust products, maintain products efficiently, and provide a better service to clients. How is big data used in practice? Rolls-Royce put big data processes to use in three key areas of their operations: design, manufacture, and after-sales support. Let's discuss each area in turn. Paul Stein, the company's chief scientific officer, says, "We have huge clusters of high-power computing which are used in the design process. We generate tens of terabytes of data on each simulation of one of our jet engines. We then have to use some pretty sophisticated computer techniques to look into that massive data set and visualize whether that particular product we've designed is good or bad." Visualizing big data is just as important as the techniques we use for manipulating it. In fact, they eventually hope to be able to visualize their products in operation in all the potential extremes of behavior in which they get used. They're already working towards this aspiration. The company's manufacturing systems are increasingly becoming networked and communicate with each other in the drive towards a networked Internet of Things, or IoT, industrial environment. We've just opened two world-class factories in the UK, in Rotherham and Sunderland.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.